Hello and welcome to the top eight of the Highlander National Championships 2017. My name is Kanishka Karunaratne from Paragon Games, and I'm here with Andrew Vance from the Highlander Points Committee.
Good afternoon.
We're about to jump into the first round of the top eight. It's Jessica, Catherine, Estephan on Blue Moon Combo, and Christopher, Addie on Jund Lands. So let's jump into the game.
Let's jump right in. So I would expect this to favour Jess in general. Mm-hmm. Chris doesn't have a huge number of outs to the combo. He's pretty good against the Blue Moon part. Blood Moon, Blue Moon, etc. aren't great against him because he's got a fair number of basics. And also he's playing red, so you know mountains aren't the worst for him.
Right.
But Time Vault combo and Splinter Twin combo are both things that he can certainly beat. Mm-hmm. If he draws the right part of his deck at the right time.
Right, okay. Chris has got cards like Ancient Grudge.
Yeah, he's got Ancient Grudge main, yep. Which is an innovation of Chris's, because there's a lot of very good artifacts in the format. Mm. From Moxes to Time Vault, all the equipment that we've seen in previous Bant matchups and so on. Mm-hmm. Being able to destroy target artifact for 2 mana and then for 1 mana is pretty exciting.
Yeah.
So Chris absolutely can win the game. I would suggest he's in the control seat for the most part. If Chris wins, it's probably going to be a fairly long match.
Okay.
Jess has the potential to end the game on.
Okay. Chris showing us the hand.
Yeah, which contained a lot of lands from the look of it. Yeah, I mean, Chris has definitely got ways to close out the game. You know, cards like Tarmogoyf and Titania and Scavenging Ooze. Mm-hmm. But Jess has got ways to close out the game on, turn two.
Yep.
Or three. So, if we get into the mid to late game, it can favor Chris. But, I mean, as with Splinter Twin in all formats, you just
win on
top deck a win out of nowhere.
Yep.
So Chris will be looking to use his disruption. He's got, a fairly healthy discard package to try and reduce the odds of that happening.
Mm-hmm.
But without having watched it, I would suggest he's not the favourite.
Mm. So what would be the key cards Chris would be looking for here?
He's going to be playing a somewhat reactive game, so Ancient Grudge, as we mentioned, is pretty good because it takes out some of the combos. Life from the Loam is going to be good because, his ideal world is that he gets the Life from the Loam strip mine lock going and just doesn't get to play the game.
Right.
If she's got no lands, casting Splinter Twin is very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Life from the Loam would be great. He's also got Gamble and Demonic Tutor, which allow him to filter through his deck. So Gamble's a somewhat unusual card that our viewers might not have seen before. So it's from, I think, the Mirage cycle that included cards like Vampiric Tutor. But instead, okay, Red got search your library for anything, put it into your hand, but then you've got to discard a card at random. So it's a lot weaker when your hand is empty.
Your hand's nice and full.
When your hand's nice and full, you've got reasonable odds. Yeah. But also, if you're fetching a card like Life from the Loam, you don't actually care if it ends up in the graveyard.
Yep.
Okay. So or if you've got Life from the Loam and you're fetching, Strip Mine or Wasteland or something.
Mm-hmm.
So it's often just a 1 mana tutor for Chris.
Right.
Yeah,
that is very powerful, like with those Dredge cards and Flashback.
Yeah, absolutely. Like that, yeah. Dredge cards, Flashback. I know it gets played in Storm by John Paul Kelly. And again, it's often, fetching a card that he doesn't really mind if it goes to the graveyard, or sometimes it's just a 20% chance to win the game, mm-hmm, an 80% chance to win the game right now.
Yep.
So,
Yeah, cool.
Those are pretty good odds.
Mm. Yeah, and this deck is more or less Chris's own little brainchild.
This is definitely Chris's baby. He's been working on this and playing this in Highlanders in Canberra for quite a few years,
mm-hmm,
which does give him a bit of an advantage. He definitely knows the format quite well. Jess is from Sydney, where they don't play Highlander as much.
Mm-hmm.
So she's probably less experienced with the various cards that can go on. So Chris has Bloodbraid Elfed into
Birds of Paradise. I think that was a Titania.
Yeah, that was a Titania going on the bottom. And the Birds is getting mental misstepped. And, in fact, everything's countered.
Right. So the Cascade goes on the stack regardless.
Cascade goes on the stack no matter what.
Yeah.
So Jess was, you know, letting that resolve so she could see what she could see.
Yep.
Before getting overexcited and
yep.
trying to counter the Blood Raid. So.
Yeah, and I think Jess has got a Chrome Mox with a red card.
Yeah, Chrome Mox with a red card.
So that blood, she, I guess she had a red mana set up for Blood Moon.
Yeah.
If that happens.
Yeah.
And there is the Thoughtseize.
Getting Cryptic'd.
Okay. Did Jess have anything in her hand to...
She had at least one other card.
Right. And she... Okay.
And, you know...
Just, she cycled. That's right. She replaced it as opposed to just not having a card in hand.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So I think she's got a couple of cards, but it's a little bit difficult to see.
I think it's just the one.
Possibly.
Yeah.
So Jess is playing the counterspells game, and Chris is trying to grind out that advantage. And there's that gamble we were talking about before.
Yeah. Looks like an original printing.
Yeah, that would be from whichever set it's from.
Okay, I'm not sure.
Yeah. As I think it's Visions or Weatherlight, whichever Vampiric Tune and so on from, but I might be wildly incorrect.
Okay, and
he's considering, look, I wouldn't be surprised if Life from the Loam was, and I think he's put Life from the Loam at the top, and he's just considering his other options. Yeah, Life from the Loam lets him just, you know, thin all the lands out of his deck. I don't think it ends up being what he took.
Yeah, he took something else.
Okay. I guess we'll find out.
I think Jess has got the dice ready for the random discard.
Yep. So Chris has got a nice full hand.
I think that was... It had to be something less than six.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Chris is discarding a land.
Okay, seems fine for him.
Seems absolutely fine for him.
Okay, and I'm not seeing any basics. Oh, wait, one basic swamp.
He's got a basic swamp.
Okay, so he'll be hoping for a forest at some point soon, I assume.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's cycling a Baron Moor.
Okay.
And
is that a...
That's an Urborg. Urborg.
Ooh, doesn't that cause, like, real headaches with Blood Moon? Oh, there it is.
Possibly.
Let's have a look. So, non-basic lands are mountains.
Yep.
So, I believe... there's probably going to be a judge that shouts at me for this, but I believe that's turned Urborg into a mountain. Therefore, Urborg's text doesn't count.
Yeah, I think because of the order they came out, that's happening. Okay. I could be wrong.
We'll get some angry judge comments in the video.
Yeah.
Okay, but I think for most... Basically, what's happened here, I think, is that basically all of Chris's lands are now mountains besides that swamp.
Besides that swamp, yeah.
And Jess has... two red sources and three blue sources. So it looks like her mana is just fine.
Yeah, although she's just lost one of her red sources
to
probably that Ancient Grudge.
That was Ancient Grudge, I think, yeah.
Which you can't flash back, but there's no targets for it anyway. Yeah. So.
Yeah, okay, so both players... Oh, no, Jess has got... Yep, she's got a red source.
Yep.
Okay.
So we might be in for a bit of Drogo here, I suspect.
I wonder if Chris... Well, Chris didn't have a green source, right? So maybe that's one of the reasons he didn't get the Life from the Loam.
Yeah, quite possibly.
Yeah.
I might have been worried about the...
The Blood Moon coming down?
The oncoming Blood Moon. So...
Okay.
Now Jess is just sort of filtering through her deck, trying to find her.
And she's got a bit of a win con on the board now, which is going to die.
Yeah.
Okay, and that gets...
Yeah, little creatures aren't going to last long against Chris Preakboard.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's got, you know, Lightning Bolt, Terminate, Chain Lightning, et cetera, et cetera.
Yep.
Fatal Push, almost certainly.
Yeah.
A
new card.
New card, which is definitely an all-star in a format like Highlander, where everyone's playing fetch lands and a bunch of other cards that are going to go to the graveyard all the time.
Yeah.
And the number of cards you're going to see in the average, number of creatures you're going to see in the average matchup that cost more than four is pretty close to zero.
Yeah.
You know, you'll see, I mean, as we've seen, the occasional Titania, the occasional Craterhoof, but...
Mm-hmm.
Fatal Push is always going to have targets, regardless of whether it's turned on.
Yep. And it's almost always trading up.
And it's almost always trading up.
Yeah. Very cool. So Chris, still no green source.
No.
And yeah, his fetches aren't going to be able to go and find one either.
Fetches aren't going to be able to find one. And Jess is just digging for one of her combos at the moment. You know, if she can find any part of them, it's she's going to be pretty favored. Because obviously the creatures that go with Splinter Twin also untap Time Vault as a happy coincidence. So we've got a Kiki-Jiki.
Okay.
Who is in beatdown mode, yeah. There's no other creatures in play to copy.
I'm not sure if I've seen that before.
Like, Highlander is a format where you see lots of strange things.
Kiki-Jiki beatdown. Was that an edict?
Or that is a Chainer's Edict.
Okay.
So it's a 2-mana sorcery that creature can pay 7 mana to flashback. But I think it requires double black, so he's going to have some difficulty casting that at the moment. Although I think he might have a second black source. Well,
I think it's just the one basic swamp right now.
I think he's got one at the top of the screen and one in the middle from the look of it.
All right, yep.
Okay. Or possibly we don't know how Urborg works. I guess we're about to find out.
Did they just get... It got countered, mana leaked.
Yeah, it got mana drained, I suspect.
Right, okay.
Yeah, there's a mana drain on top of Jess's graveyard.
Okay.
Mana drain, one of Jess's points.
And Terminate, okay.
A Dreadbore, I think.
Oh, Dreadbore, sorry, yeah.
So, yeah. From Chris's second basic swamp and one of his many mountains.
Okay, and I guess in a deck like... So, Edicts aren't always excellent, but I guess in a deck like Chris's where he's just killing everything that shows up,
yeah,
you're probably going to get what you want to get.
They're killing everything that shows up, and particularly in a matchup like this where Jess doesn't have a lot of
targets for removal.
Yeah. A lot of creatures, so she's not that often going to have... She's usually going to have sort of one or two or a million. And when she's got a million, you don't care because you're already dead.
Yep. So Chris hasn't really been casting anything. I've got a suspicion his hand is full of green spells.
Look, his hand could be full of green spells. Could also just be a lot of removal.
Right. Oh, there's a top.
And a Vidalcan Shackles. So Chris is going to have to deal with the shackles, amongst many other things. He's going to have to deal with the shackles before he kills anything, because Jess can steal a creature that costs up to about seven at the moment, six.
Six, I think, yeah.
Which is going to cover off Chris's whole deck.
There are the shackles.
Yeah.
So she can gain control of a creature with power less than the number of islands she controls.
Yeah.
Which is...
Oh, six. It's powerless, so yeah.
Yep. That's going to get...
That's going to get everything.
Yep.
If he's got a... If he somehow resolved a Tarmogoyf with all possible types, I think she can't steal it right now. Oh, no, now she can.
Yeah. Okay, that's up.
Yeah.
Okay, and more Blood Moon backup.
Yep. And a Blood Moon that can attack.
Yep. Seems good.
Makers of the Moon, look, in general, the weakest of the three, because it's much easier to kill.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know... She's still going to do 19 more damage to Chris at some point. Chris, flashing back that Chainer's Edict. No. Playing a land first and then flashing it back.
Okay.
In case of...
Some sort of...
Multiple mana leak type effects, yep. I guess.
And spinning the top.
Yep.
In response.
Yes, indeed. We have... Fry's favorite thing, a double top mirror, I'm pretty sure. Because I'm pretty sure Chris is playing Sensei's Divining Top. Because in the Jund colors, there's not a lot of sources of card filtering and card advantage. Mm-hmm. So Sensei's Top is one of the few ways that lets you get there.
Okay. And it looks like she just...
So that was a Riptide Lab down in the corner.
Mm-hmm.
Riptide Laboratory lets you bounce wizards for a blue and one, I think.
Okay.
So it lets you, rebuy your Snapcasters, Venser, those sorts of cards if she's playing them. Vendilion Cleek is another good one that just lets you wreck your opponent's hand.
Yeah, right. Vendilion Cleek's a wizard.
I believe so.
Okay.
It's a fairy wizard, probably.
It is too.
Being from Lorwyn, where everything had all the creature types available. Vendilion Cleek being one that used pretty much every available space on the type line.
Mm-hmm. yeah, it just gets a...
I think you could have maybe two additional letters.
That'd be pushing it.
Yeah.
Like an L and an I, maybe?
Yeah.
Okay. Simple case. Yeah.
Okay. It could be a L-wizard.
Oh, okay. Tezzeret
has arrived. And Tezzeret threatens to end the game pretty quickly. Because it can fetch out Vidalcan Shackles or Time Vault. It can also untap the Time Vault, and she does have a Time Vault. So Chris is going to need something pretty special right now, which she does not have.
And a scoop is the response.
Yep.
Okay. So, yeah, I guess red and black are the colors traditionally unable to deal with enchantments.
Yeah.
Green can, but he didn't have a green source. So he might have had an answer in hand, just unable to do anything about it.
Quite possibly. So let's have a quick squiz at their sideboards.
All right, let's have a look at Jess first.
So Jess's sideboard, she's got a variety of cards that answer creatures in general.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, cards like Anger of the Gods and Submerge, which I think puts green creatures back on top of libraries from memory.
If they control the forest.
Yep. It's possible she
and
might go
for the island. Yep. Okay.
It's possible she might go for the counterbalance plan. Unclear. Okay. Glen on Lender Archmage is pretty good because it eats up two of Chris's removal spells.
Right.
She's got the option of Blue Elemental Blast and Hydro Blast if she thinks she needs it. I'm not sure she's going to go for that.
Okay.
But those are options. But that's. She doesn't have anything which deals with the graveyard, which. Might be very favorable for Chris.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, it's a smattering of upgrades to removal. She's got the option of the counterbalance plan. Otherwise, okay. Not a huge amount for this matchup, I don't think.
So I guess if she's going on counterbalance, she really wants to find that the Divining Top.
Yeah, look, Divining Top, yeah, absolutely. Okay. Counterbalance Top is a lot better than just counterbalance.
Yeah.
And what do we got on Chris's sideboard?
Let's see.
So Chris has got a couple of fairly potent options. So he's got Duress, which he'll almost certainly side in just to round out the discard package.
Very good discard spell.
Choke is an excellent option because it lets him play back to basics in reverse, essentially. So it stops all of Jess's islands untapping, which he's going to be pretty excited by.
Yeah, I imagine.
Cruising Grip, I would also imagine, is highly potent because it can't be countered and it destroys... all of Jess's combo pieces, except the creatures, I guess, but he's got plenty of options there. Red Blast and Pyro Blast, I would absolutely imagine they're coming in because they let him counter some of her key spells.
And once they've resolved, she can...
That's right. He can kill Tezzeret, which we saw ending that game, or counter it. True Name Nemesis, if Jess has that. They're pretty versatile, and they counter or kill... a very large percentage of cards in her deck. And Chris isn't going to know exactly what her list is. So if she's playing True Name Nemesis, it's one of a handful of cards he's got that can deal with that, because you can kill it when it's getting cast. Damnation and Bonfire, probably not. Fire Spout's pretty unexciting. Mm. Grafdigger's Cage, not impossible, but it seems...
I guess it stops the Snapcaster.
It stops Snapcaster, but that... I don't think that's the game Chris wants to be playing here.
Yeah.
And Thrun... is, you know, an uncounterable, unkillable threat. I don't think Chris is going to sideboard that in, but it might be better than some of the other top-end threats he's got for the matchup.
Okay.
So let's see how close we get.
Right. Yeah, so, Chris's land's just really... I guess, just really preying on these multicolor land mana bases.
Yeah, look, the Blue Moon decks prey... pretty heavily on the 3 and 4 color mana bases.
Mm-hmm.
Chris, as I said, is probably better equipped than average, but sometimes they just get you.
Yep. And they're just not finding a basic forest at all.
And
just locking, I assume, a pretty big chunk of his deck out.
Yeah, it locks out a chunk of his deck, locks out the whole Life from the Loan plan.
Yep.
I mean, because for starters, it turns the wastelands into mountains, which are much less exciting.
Mm-hmm.
And... is in general, just a strong impediment. There's going to be plenty of starts he's got where it's a brick, but that was not one of them.
Yeah. So what is his game plan here? I'm sure he knew what Jess was on when he came in, but maybe his main deck wasn't really tuned to beat that. So what's his what's he looking for here early in the game?
Look, as before, I mean, he's looking for ways to deal with the combo pieces, but I would imagine he's going to be pretty excitedly trying to get that Life from the Loan plan going.
Okay.
But he's casting probably Inquisition? No.
I think it's an Entomb.
Ah, okay, he's casting Entomb for Life of the Lobe. Right. Yeah, so again, Entomb, he behaves kind of similarly to Gamble for him. Mm-hmm. It lets him just get one of those pieces from his graveyard package and put it in the bin where he wants it to be.
Okay.
So for at least a couple of turns, Chris is not going to be drawing any cards that aren't called Life from the Lobe.
Okay. yeah, and that is in the graveyard.
Yeah. Yeah, so...
Was it a tutor?
No, it was
in his... Okay, and he drew that instead of
his draw. Yeah, he drew that instead of having his draw step. So now he can get Urborg and that fetch land back,
mm-hmm.
Potentially, and start thinning out his deck. Jess can counter it, but that's not a long-term viable strategy.
Yeah.
Depending on her hand, it might still be, you know, a game-winning plan. She might just need to delay him for a couple of turns from doing that,
mm-hmm.
And then potentially take all the rest of the turns in the game with Time Vault. But certainly from Chris's side, the Life from the Lone plan is pretty exciting here.
Okay, and so why is this so powerful against Blue Moon?
It's very hard for them to interact with, and it means that Chris is going to have all the lands of all the colors he wants, more or less immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And
he's somersaulting card.
Yep, he's accidentally flipped a card off the top of his deck. the judge will tell him to put that back in shuffle.
Yeah,
you know, don't do it again, etc.
Okay.
Okay.
So is this what this plan does? Is basically give Chris all the lands he needs to fight through a Blood Moon.
Yeah, and it gives him potentially a lot of card advantage in the form of the cycling lands like Barrenmoor.
Right.
So he can just draw those every turn and draw extra cards,
mm-hmm.
And put a lot of his deck into the graveyard. And what he ideally wants is the strip waste combo.
Okay.
So that he can just stop Jess from having any lands, so that she can't, you know, combo off.
Right. Okay. So I was just keep returning strip mine and wasteland. Blow up two lands.
Well, you can't blow up two lands a turn because you can only play one, but...
Right, yeah, destroy a land each turn and then just get it back again.
You destroy a land each turn and get it back again, yeah, absolutely. Right. It's possibly still playing Fast Bond, I don't recall from his deck list, but that would let him play multiple lands a turn.
Okay.
So now he's DTing, and I think the odds... Yeah, Jess agrees, the odds he's tutoring for strip mine are extremely high, so she does not allow that.
Okay.
Because if he got a strip mine and a life on the line this early in the game, game's just over.
Yeah. Yeah, she needs the land drops.
Yeah. Yeah, if she makes a land drop every turn, she can stake on two lands, and if she doesn't, Chris just gets to take away all her mana and eventually deploy whatever threat he feels like to end the game with.
Okay, so he's kind of in the control deck.
Yeah.
Currently, which is very strange. But
yeah, look, Jund often ends up in a sort of control position. Mm-hmm. Where he's got some amount of inevitability and his opponent is just hoping to, you know, finish the game before that happens.
Mm-hmm.
Jess has got a lot of control options as well. I mean, as we saw, you know, she's got mana leaks and mana drains and so on.
Yep.
She can try and stop him completing his dastardly plan.
Mm. And looks like Chris has already gone and fetched two basic... forest, so obviously.
Yeah. Chris is
going to green mana above anything else currently.
Yeah, Chris is going to be fetching as many basics as he can at this point.
Mm-hmm.
I think the only fetch he's got is the Windswept Heath, which is why he hasn't fetched a mountain or a swamp.
Okay.
Okay,
and there's that.
There's that Barrenmoor, which is going to allow him to. Although he does have a basic swamp in his bin, which he might be fetching back here.
Okay.
Yes, he is indeed fetching it back. And
again, Daisy and the Life from the Loam.
Yep, Daisy and the Life from the Loam. Chris could have played a land in advance to avoid that, but he, I suspect, wanted to play that basic swamp because
mm-hmm.
It lets him cycle the Barrenmoor.
Yep.
Because one of the advantages the Barrenmoor has is it protects Life from the Loam, so if your opponent's got graveyard removal, you can... cycle the Barrenmoor in response and get the Life from the Loam back, and you still might lose the rest of your graveyard,
mm-hmm.
but at least you've got your engine.
Right. Okay. I guess, I mean, that card just turns into an extra card every turn.
Yeah.
If you're returning that, yeah, with life.
Yep. So Jess is thinking about
whether this one resolves.
Whether this one resolves.
Yeah, and it just feels like an uphill battle countering those Life from the Looms.
Definitely is.
Yeah.
So Chris is getting back Baron Moor, Swamp Bunny. He's got a treetop. So, you know, a nice uncounterable win condition eventually.
Okay.
But just, I don't think he's in any great rush.
Yeah, and just continuing on the play the basics line.
Yep, play the basics, cast Life from the Loam as often as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, see, he did definitely side in the Pyroblasts.
Yep.
If you're drawing three cards a turn, even if they're all lands, it's pretty good.
Yeah. Okay, there's a she's going to mana link the second one.
Yeah.
But I think
he'll have to stop eventually because, you know, he doesn't want to deck himself, but he's got a good 15 Life from the Loams before that happens.
Mm-hmm.
So Jess is
finding a basic
mountain
there.
Right.
But I mean, Blood Moon's just not looking quite as good as it could be anymore.
No. I don't know if there's any cards in Chris's deck that he can't cast through a Blood Moon at this point.
Because he's already got two non-basics, which will turn into mountains.
Which will turn into mountains.
So he's basically got two red, two green, and a black source.
Yep.
On the board, yeah.
I mean, it's not impossible that the Blood Moon might actually improve his mana here.
Yeah. But I suspect he's maybe intentionally been... Oh, no, he hasn't had a way to fetch red, has he?
He hasn't had a way to fetch red. Okay. So we've got a back to basics, which will slow him down, but, you know, only briefly. Because as soon as he flips a red fetch into the bin,
mm-hmm.
He's got a basic mount. So,
yeah.
Back to basics, delaying but not ending the game. It stops Treetop Village from doing anything of any particular use because mm-hmm. it comes into play tapped and then just stays tapped.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think Chris deciding to draw for the turn there rather than he might already have Life in the Loam in his hand.
Gonna play the Oh wow! There you go, Rex Sage.
Get wrecked. And she's asking if he's choosing a target, which he definitely is. She doesn't have a 2-mana counter for it, so
it resolves
and back to basics is dealt with.
Yep.
So as we were saying before, Chris has got a lot of options for answers.
Yeah, and now he's got a win condition on the board as well.
Yeah,
not the most powerful, but
I can't imagine it's going to survive that long. Yeah. But it certainly has the option of attacking 20 times or 10 times.
Yeah. But I guess what Chris has been doing is just like forcing Jessica to basically respond to everything he's doing.
Yeah.
He's been dictating the pace of the game and what's been happening.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. So she's possibly out of cards as well, I think.
Right, yeah.
She's got a small hand.
Two or three.
Those black sleeves are
three cards, I think.
Hard to see. And now she's only got one because that's a him to Turak.
Yeah.
Turak, you don't want to sing about him. So she's discarding a mountain and something. Himstrike from that weird period where to increase the number of printings in the set, there was a bunch of cards that had multiple arts.
Oh, really?
So there's three or four Himstrike arts, I believe.
From the same set.
From the same set.
Oh, weird.
There's a bunch of other cards. Like the Pump Knights had multiple arts and so on.
Okay.
So
that would be for any OCD collector.
Yeah, yeah.
That would make life hard.
Yep. So Chris is casting, maybe that's Choke, I think.
Maybe.
Yeah, I think that's Choke.
Yeah, it looks like a Choke. Apologies about the white quarter.
Yep. Now the, you know,
this is trouble for Jess.
The land hate is on the other foot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's absolutely trouble for Jess. She's not going to have a lot of ways to remove an enchantment.
Mm-hmm. I guess Cryptic could bounce it.
Cryptic could bounce it, no, it doesn't seem but like that's
a great way to do it.
Yeah. And Chris has got a Wasteland. Wasteland's not as good here as it is in some matchups because, but by the nature of the deck, she's not playing a lot of non-basics. So she'll have like a Volcanic and a Steam Vents. A couple of those colorless lands, but not much else.
Yeah, I'm just getting attacks in there with the Rexage and Treetop Village.
Yep, so I think Chris has decided that, you know, now it's time for him to start closing out the game.
Mm-hmm. And that's just Wasteland again, isn't it? Yep.
Yeah, so he's getting back Wasteland in case he needs it. Because one of the things Wasteland does here is it means Jess can't have a blue source that untaps more than once. So mm-hmm. Choke's keeping all the basics in check, mm-hmm. all the basic islands in check. But, you know, now she's got a Minimo or some other random blue-producing land, he can just eat it. And he can tap it for black because he's got Urborg in play.
Yeah, so he gets the cycle.
Does everything.
The Baron War.
Yeah.
All right. And you can see, like, yeah, you often see this, right, when someone's on the control deck and they realize they've turned the corner.
Yeah.
Oh, and I think he just found the...
Found a strip mine.
Strip mine, yeah. Okay. And he's just... His pace of play is just sped up.
Yeah, yeah.
He knows what he's doing. This is the part of the game he's planned for and he's used to.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so before attacks, it looks like Jess wants to do something.
Yep, so... Jess is casting Vendilion Click.
Okay. Where's that fairy wizard?
Now, everyone's favorite fairy wizard.
There can't be too many fairy wizards, can there?
There's a few.
Okay.
They're all from Law 1, but there's a few.
Okay. And she's choosing her own hand, okay.
Yeah. That makes sense. She had some cards that she couldn't easily cast or couldn't keep casting.
Yeah. Chris happy to just make that trade there.
Well, yeah, taking out the treetop, he doesn't really care about it because he's just going to play it again immediately.
Mm-hmm. Courtesy of Life from the Loom.
Courtesy of Life from the Loom. And you can see with the way his graveyard's laid out, it's one of the annoying features of Highlander that because there's some cards that care about graveyard order,
yeah.
You're not allowed to just reorder your graveyard however you want.
Oh, wow. Yeah, okay.
It's
actually got to be in order.
Yeah.
Awkward.
And it's in a slightly messy order, but it's essentially in order.
Yeah, right.
And this is because of you know, Ashen Ghoul and Nether Shadow and a couple of cards like that. That okay. Basically no one plays, but because they exist and you could be playing them, Graveyard Order matters.
I think I actually ended up playing against one of these cards in a Block Wars event once.
Yeah,
that was weird.
Yeah, so Ashen Ghoul, it's a 3-1 with haste, and you can return it into play, but only if there's three creatures above it in your graveyard.
Well, I am glad they stopped doing these effects.
Yeah, and look, they stopped it for this reason, because it was a nightmare to keep track of.
Yeah.
Very easy for shady people to try and, you know, cheat.
Angle shoot with it.
Yeah. Made people care about what order their creatures went to the graveyard and so on, if you raft, which, you know.
Yeah, right, okay.
So there's just a pile of tiny little annoying interactions that go with it.
Okay.
So now Chris is attacking with a Tarmogoyf.
Yeah, it looks like a Tarmogoyf.
That's going to be a pretty big Tarmogoyf. Jess is on 2, so... We're definitely in the closing stages of this game.
Yeah,
and Chris is probably about to have to discard because he's got too many cards because he's been living the lone life.
Yeah, and I think Chris has played a lot of time ago, so I think he's pretty quick at calculating how big it is.
Yeah. So Jess is cracking a fetch here to thin out our library and try and just, you know...
Yeah, that strip mine has just been rip doing a combo. Work.
Yeah.
Does she have an out here? Like, can she do it?
Look, if she had a Voltaic Key in her hand, she could play a Time Vault, and that's probably, you know... She could play a Time Vault and have exactly one source that untaps, but eventually she'd win.
Yeah.
Eventually she'd, you know, draw into Seaver Exarch and Splinter Twin or something.
Right.
But, you know, I'm not convinced she has a Voltaic Key in her hand, so she probably doesn't have... So she looks like she's got a Blast, and yeah, the game's over.
Yeah. Wow.
And Chris's enormous graveyard has to get shuffled back into his library. But that game went pretty much exactly
the way Chris
wants it to.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Life from the Loam just doing overtime there.
Life from the Loam is an incredible engine in these sort of matchups. And it's also one that doesn't take up a lot of space in Chris's deck.
Mm-hmm.
So Strip Mine and Wasteland he might be playing anyway. Gamble and Entomb... Probably not. Life from the Loam, you know. But so that's 5 cards out of his 60.
Mm-hmm.
And can win games that the rest of his deck struggles with.
Yeah.
And it means that he's hard to sideboard against for opponents because they don't know which of his plans he's going to be going for.
Mm. And they're all kind of just implicitly there, right? Like, he doesn't really have to board too much to make them work?
No, yeah. Look... Gamble and Entomb are the only cards that you might not otherwise play.
Yep.
And neither of them is terrible. Like, they both do things. Mm-hmm. You know, entombing an ancient grudge is sometimes going to be pretty sweet.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's a pretty light package. He hasn't, I've talked to him about this before, he hasn't committed more heavily to it. So he's not, I think he actually isn't playing Fastbond anymore. And he's not playing, like, Oracle of Moldiah or, you know, those sorts of cards that you play extra lands because they don't do enough on their own.
Mm-hmm.
So he just wants to have this nice little compact option in his deck
mm-hmm.
That he can ignore if it's not going to do anything.
Yep.
And as we saw here, sometimes just generates so much card advantage that your opponent can't cope.
Yeah.
You know, as we saw there, he only played about two or three spells in that game that weren't called Life from the Loam.
Yeah. Yeah, and it was mostly just the Rex Sage that he just landed.
Yeah, he landed a creature.
Back to basics and just, yeah.
Yep, took control of the game with it and, you know, he had some other creatures eventually to speed up the clock, but it was basically just Life from the Loam, build up my graveyard until you can't possibly survive.
Yeah. All right, and it looks like they did minimal sideboarding there. I think there was one or two cards that came in and out.
Yeah.
Like,
not sure what those might have been.
Yeah, I can't imagine the plan changes too much on the play or draw.
No, plan doesn't change too much on the play or draw. It's possible Jess might have wanted to take out the Hydro Blast if she brought them in, because Chris's deck, although it's got red cards in it, doesn't. His most important cards are green and black for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and I think he did actually have a red fetch that he just didn't ever, or a red jewel that he just never picked up.
Yeah,
when he was learning before. So.
Well, yeah, because once he dealt with the back to basics, you know.
Yeah, just didn't matter.
Didn't matter. So Chris, I think they're both going back.
Yeah.
I
guess they're both looking for very specific cards.
Well, looking for specific cards, and you know, it's Magic. You get flooded and mana screwed occasionally, so. Jess probably looking like she ideally wants a quick combo,
because
as she's just experienced, the longer the game goes, the more chance Chris has to start just grinding her out.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the advantages of a deck like Jund lands, much like Jund in any format, it doesn't have a lot of, you know, 60 or 70% matchups, but it's got very few 20% matchups.
Okay.
Like, it's pretty bad against some of the really dedicated combo decks. Like, I think Chris basically can't beat Storm.
Okay.
Unless he gets super lucky.
Right.
But against everything else, he's, you know, 50-something percent or 40, high 40s percent, which lets his experience with the deck and the format come to the fore.
Yep.
So, I think that's his theory.
Yeah, okay.
And Chris is there wearing that CBR MTG t-shirt.
Yeah.
Representing Canberra.
Yeah, and both players got their pretty nice looking playmats.
Yeah, like, I mean, I'm not in love with the Born of the Gods one, but yeah.
It's colourful. Yeah, so both obviously established players having top-aided WMCQs.
WMCQs.
Oh, one of them was a, sorry, Pro Tour PTQ.
Ah, yes.
Yep.
Back when those existed.
Times have changed. Okay, looks like they've both kept.
Yep, so they both kept their six. Jess did keep the Hydro Blasts in, because I can see it in her hand. And Chris is leading with some kind of...
Ooh, Inquisition.
Inquisition.
I think he's got one target. I'm not sure what that last card is.
He's got three targets. So Imperial Recruiter, Blood Moon, or the Blast.
Right.
Depending on Chris's hand, Blood Moon might be the target. Otherwise, Imperial Recruiter. Because Imperial Recruiter lets you, for more mana than Jess have, build up. Yeah, it lets you build up the Splinter Twin combo, because you can fetch Kiki Jiki with Imperial Recruiter.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can copy the Imperial Recruiter to go and fetch Deceiver Exarch, and then go off.
Right.
Okay,
so there's a quick combo that...
Yeah. I mean, you've got to be able to cast them all.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it requires a fair amount of mana, but you can spread it over multiple turns and, you know, it is pretty sweet.
Oh, wow.
So, Duress, probably taking the Blood Moon, I would guess. Oh, no, Tezzeret.
Yep, Tezzeret.
Chris is just saying, no combos for you.
Yeah.
And,
yeah, I guess he's just ready to to just fetch another basic.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And yep, he can fetch a basic forest, and then the Blood Moon's just mostly irrelevant.
Nothing, yeah.
And
again, he's like, the Blood Moon fixes infrared, if that's what he needs to do.
Yeah, not right now, but it sure will. Yeah.
There's a Ancestral Visions.
Yeah, Ancestral Visions. Not as good as Ancestral Recall, but it is four less points. Okay. Which is obviously something that comes up a fair amount in Highlander. You do often have to play the, you know, the poor cousin, because you've only got 7 points to go around.
Mm-hmm.
Jess is spending three of hers on the Time Vault. Mm-hmm. Not 100% sure where she's spending the rest of them, but, you know, just Time Vault and Ancestral might not be where she wants to be.
Mm-hmm. And I guess her deck is designed to play the long game, and so, like, it doesn't necessarily matter for her. I mean, it's still drawing three cards, even if it's a bit later, is still pretty good for her.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Ooh.
Tireless Tracker.
Standard All-Star.
It's pretty good in a deck like Chris's. I mean, as we've seen, he plays a lot of lands.
He does too.
So the ability to turn those lands into more cards later is pretty good for him. Plus, it's a bit of a, you know, must-deal-with threat.
Mm.
Yeah,
it snowballs in many ways.
Yeah, that's right.
How threatening it is and how much cards it's going
to
draw you.
That's right. And once it gets up to, you know, a 5/4 or a 6/5, it's a very big creature.
Mm-hmm.
And
I mean, even a 4/3, it's pretty good.
4/3 is reasonable, but it's not great in Highlander because there's so many, you know, lightning bolts
and
such.
Right, yeah.
But
once it's out of that 3 damage range.
Once it's out of that 3 damage range, it's pretty durable.
Yeah, and obviously, Jess did not have a way to stop that entering the battlefield.
Yeah, and Chris knows a fair number of the cards in her hand, so she's still got that Blood Moon and that Hydro Blast. He can just, you know, hold off playing red spells.
Yeah.
To make the Hydro Blast dead. As we've discussed, the Blood Moon's already pretty dead.
Yep, and he just entombed.
He just entombed life from the loam.
This can't be good for Jess.
No. No, particularly, again, with the Tireless Tracker in play, where Life from the Loam turns every fetch land into two clues.
Yep.
I
think she might have missed her land drop last turn. Because Chris is now ahead on lands.
Yeah, she must have. Okay. Well, because when she got Duress, she only had one more land in hand. So she's casting the Blood Moon anyway.
Yep. With the Hydro Blast.
With the Hydro Blast still up. Yep. Because, look, you might as well. And, look, it does stop those various Life from the Loam shenanigans we saw in the last game.
Because
It looks like Chris might have... Is that the Wasteland in his hand? I'm not sure.
He's deciding whether to dredge.
Yeah, deciding whether it's worth dredging in this situation. Which I imagine he's probably going to decide to do, but I guess we'll find out shortly.
Yeah.
No, just draw.
Okay. His hand is just fine.
Yep. Well, he definitely has at least one other land in his hand.
I think he's got a Rexage.
He does have a Rexage. So, and a Blood Braid.
Okay.
Which he can now cast.
Because of Blood Moon.
The
Robins. And that's Gamble, is it?
That's Gamble, which I suspect he might not cast.
Oh, he gets the option.
So with Cascade spells, you can decide not to cast them. So that if your Blood Braid hits Terminate and it's the only creature in play, you can just go, I will pass on that option.
Okay.
But she is not giving him the opportunity to cast it.
Okay, so it is a you may.
Yep.
Yep.
So he tried to cast it and she decided not to let him.
Okay. I guess it was like, for him, it's like, that card's just going to be gone anyway, so
yeah,
it's just a way to get that. If it resolves, great, but
yep.
If she pyroblasted, then now the rest of his red spells are just online.
Yep. Because, at the moment, Blood Moon's... I mean, as I said earlier, sometimes Blood Moon just wins the game.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's just a 3-mana textless spell.
Yep.
And
especially when your opponent knows it's coming.
When your opponent knows it's coming, and especially when your opponent's playing, you know, red cards themselves.
Yep.
It can just do nothing.
Yeah, now he's just made two cards off the Tireless Tracker.
Yep. So he's gaining one of them to grow his tracker. I think Chris is at the point where he's just going to try and close this out.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's got, like, what, 7 power on the board already?
He's got 7 power on the board, which is about to be sort of 9 power pretty quickly.
Yeah.
because he life from the land that turn, so we know he's got at least a couple more lands in his hand. Mm-hmm. Almost certainly mountains. And yeah, there's that Riptide Lab again. So
that's it. Jess has hit a lot of land drops now.
Jess has hit a lot of land drops, and she can, as we've seen previously, she's got plenty of options that just immediately end the game in her favor.
Yeah, she plays Capsize, I think, does she?
Not sure.
Okay.
Well,
that's a way to reset a tracker.
Yeah, that's a way to reset a tracker. You know, she could, if she hits Tezzeret here, she can hit, pick up half of her combo.
Mm-hmm.
Although it won't work against Chris's Rexage, but she doesn't know that. She's also in a position where if she's got a Deceiver Exarch or a Pestermite, she can just, you know, cast it, tap something down, untap, end the game.
Yep.
So
how much does Chris... Can Chris afford to play around something like that? I think he's just failed to hit lands multiple times off a life from the land.
Yeah, I think he has.
But, I mean, look at his board. I don't think he cares that much.
Nah.
Okay. And I don't think Jess really needs to fight that.
No, it's actually... I guess he wants to be able to use his fetch land so that Life on the Loam is better.
Right.
And it makes, you know, a giant pile of clues. Okay. And now we've got a Cryptic, which she could not cast a second ago.
She's bouncing.
She's bouncing the Tireless Tracker and...
she's going to take the three?
No, tapping his creatures.
Oh, okay, bouncing and tapping. Okay. Yeah, she can't really afford to take too much here.
So yeah, her life is precarious.
Mm. And Chris is sort of irrelevant, right? She's just trying to, at this point, just trying to combo.
Yeah, absolutely. Chris isn't going to take 17 damage in little bits. Mm. He's going to take it either without taking any additional turns or from a million 1/4s.
Yep.
Yeah,
and unfortunately, like, I'm sure Jess would have loved to just draw a card with that Cryptic there. But just
she probably couldn't afford the three life.
Yeah, it would have been. Yeah, the Rexage was cast this turn. Yeah.
Although, I mean, Chris gets back to having lethal on board, so maybe drawing a card might have been an option. But,
yeah, but
one way or another, this game probably ends now. Mm. It's possible she's got a Snapcaster. Mm-hmm. And can, you know, rebuy the Cryptic and gain a bit more time.
Yep. Okay, going to six.
Yeah. She could also have, I don't know if she's got any, did she have Anger of the Gods in her sideboard?
She did, yeah.
She could have an Anger. That'd be pretty exciting.
I think she'd be right back in the game if she did that.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Like,
takes care of part of Chris's engine, kills three of his creatures. You know,
yeah, it just gives everybody a bit of breathing.
Is a general all around good time. So she's just considering her options. I don't think any of those cards is Anger of the Gods.
Nice.
No.
Right, that's it.
No, she's fetched, she's looked at her deck in her hand, and then she's gone, we're done here.
Yeah, wow.
So yeah. Chris advances to the semifinals.
Yeah. Yeah, just showing like he really knew what was going on in this matchup, what mattered to him, and at what point. He needs to sit back on that life from the loom and when he needs to just put some things on the board and start beating down.
Yep.
Yeah, wow. And bad luck to Jess. It's just like, I guess Chris's game plan and just choices he made just lined up very, very well against what was...
Yeah, her draw in the third game wasn't amazing.
Yep. But it was also kind of torn apart by the discard spell. So
absolutely.
Inquisition and Duress just really...
absolutely. It took away the...
took away the Tezzeret.
Imperial Recruiter and the Tezzeret, mm-hmm. which would have fetched various combo pieces for her.
Yep.
So now we're on to the semis.
Yeah, cool. Awesome. Thanks for watching. We'll be back very soon with the semifinals.